my fella, my guy. Tell me your stellar and fly. By the time I'm out the door, yes, and man down like Rosemore. I treated myself like I knew. Show you how it's to remember. You know that I'm the other. Upstairs in bed with my ex-boy. He's in no place, but I can't get joy. Thinking of you in the final throes. This is where I've run out to meet your chills and better. And you say when we marry, cause you're not missing. There'll be not a help no more. I cry for you on the kitchen floor. I cheated myself like I knew I would. I show you. Will I how you again? I'm in the tub and you on the sea. Lick your lips as I soak my face. And then you notice a little carpet burn. My stomach drop and my guts churn. You shrug and it's the worst. Who truly stuck my knife.
Good evening, everyone, and a very, very warm welcome to this session in our series of Jewish Literary Festival at Home webinars. Thank you so much for joining us again this evening. And a few housekeeping items first. As always, season ticket holders have access to all sessions until the end of the series, which is planned to end at the end of November. But single session tickets can be purchased through SnapScan or EFT. So tell those friends who maybe find a session of interest that they can sign up and pay only 40 Rand. Details are on our website, jewishliteraryfestival.co.za, or can always be found on our Facebook page as well. Our panelists are very eager to answer questions, so please type them into the Zoom Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen, which will be available throughout the session. Those questions will then be answered by our guests during the final 10 to 15 minutes of the webinar. Finally, please watch your inbox for invitations for the upcoming events. And if you are a single session person, please remember to send your proof of payment to Natasha Skorik, whose email you'll find on our mailers. So tonight we turn our attention to golf. And this is actually the first of a sporting session within the series. And unsung hero Papwa Sewgolum, a South African professional golfer of ethnic Indian origin, who carved a niche for himself in golfing folklore when he became the first golfer of color to win a provincial open in South Africa. Golf aficionado and author Barry Cohen brings us his story in his book, Let Me Play, whilst veteran journalist and author Luke Alfred probes deeper into the story as he talks to Barry. Barry hails from Muizenberg, is a scratch golfer and law graduate. After co-developing a large video franchise chain in Australia, he returned to South Africa and launched the lottery scratch cards for Red Cross, the Fantasy League, which later became the Supersport Dream League in South Africa and Australasia, and the Springbok supporter clubs worldwide. As CEO, he led the transformation of the South African Cancer Association. He founded the Southern Africa Golf Hall of Fame and Museum. Let Me Play is his third book. Luke is a longtime journalist and also with 25 years experience in the print industry. His latest book with Ian Hawkey is called Vuvuzela Dawn and was published by Pan Macmillan last year. So settle back and enjoy this conversation with Barry and Luke as we explore the life of Papwa Sewgolum and the talent that apartheid so tragically denied. And a warm welcome to Barry and Luke.
Evening, Barry.
Hello, Luke.
Hi, Barry. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Good.
Hi.
Hi. First up, I just wanted to ask a very straightforward question to get the ball rolling, as it were. The Papwa stories has been fairly well covered. I know at least of two other books. Why did you feel you had something to add?
Well, neither of those two books were accurate, and they also didn't. They were motivated by, let's say, some other objectives. Also, those two people were not golfers, so they didn't tell the story from a golf point of view. And I think it's very important that that people understand how good Papwa was and the competition he played against. There were actually two books in one chapter. Craig Urquhart, in his book, wrote a chapter on Papwa as well.
How did you go about selecting the title for the book, Barry?
You know, Papwa, all he wanted to do was play. And he was non-political, but he was thrust into the forefront of politics insofar as he became the figurehead of the anti-apartheid sport movement in 63. And he was, his manager headed up the trade unions and wanted him to get very involved. And he was reluctant. He just wanted to play. You know, one must understand, who is Papwa? Papwa was a man who grew up in Durban, in Riverside. He grew up in a shack. His mother was blind, went blind very early. And he lost his father when he was 11. He never went to school, so he couldn't read or write. And he had to go and work when he was 11. He started as a caddy when he was 13. And he was only discovered when he was 27, which is very late for a golfer. And of course, you need a benefactor. But so all he wanted to do was play. So let me play is basically his plea to the country and to the government. Oh dear. Am I the only one here?
It looks like we've lost Luke.
Okay. Well, shall I ask myself questions?
No, I'm sure we'll get him back. If anyone in our audience has a question that they'd like to ask us quickly, well, ask Barry, please do post it for us. Otherwise, Beryl will have to do this interview.
Well, you know, let me talk a little bit about Papwa. Why is he so important? He only started, there was a parallel golf tour called the TPA tour. It was for people of color, and that was supposed to be parallel, but it was unequal. He wasn't allowed to play in white tournaments. He wasn't allowed to play on white golf courses. They played in the bush. And the only time he played on a white golf course was before 9 a.m. on a Monday morning. They allowed them to play, the caddies to play on the golf course. Hi, Luke. Well, I can see his back. Almost.
Almost there. I think it's just the audio now.
Well,
Barry, I think do carry on telling us.
Right. So Papwa played, he was encouraged to play at 16 in the Natal non-European amateur, and he won it. They were reluctant to give him his trophy because he was so young, but nevertheless, they gave it to him. What was important is he played with a reverse grip. So unlike everybody who plays today, he held the club the other way around, which was had never been done before. It so happened that a few years later, 4 years later, his main competitor, Ismail Chagli on the non-European tour, also held the club upside down, if you could put it that way. Anyway, he did play and he won four Natal Opens, non-European Opens. And then he was 27 and he was caddying barefoot at the Beechwood Golf Club in Durban. And he actually was asked by the person he was caddying for to give him a club. He gave him a club. The person hit a poor shot, blamed Papwa. Papwa was decided to leave, and he was called back by one of the other guys. It just so happened that this other guy, Graham Wolfe, who had just invented what was to be oil of Olay, called him back and said, you know, why did you give him this club? And Papwa said, well, I do play a bit. At that stage, he was a plus one handicap, the only person of color being a plus one. And he hit a super shot, and a few days later, Wolf suggested to him that he comes works for him, and that they'll see what they can do to further his career. And so he went to work in this factory, just putting on caps onto the lids on the oil of Olay. And well, they tried to get him to be allowed to play in the South African tournaments. The government said no ways. They tried to get him to play in Australia. Australia, their policies were even worse than South Africa. And so eventually they said, okay, well, let us go and sign you up for the British Open. And the Open, they accepted his entry, but now he had a challenge. How was he going to fly there? Because SAA didn't fly black people, with the exception unless there was a huge crowd of empty space around them. So Wolf said, well, don't worry, I'm going to go and buy a four-seater aeroplane, a little Piper aeroplane. And he bought one, and he and Papwa and Wolf's wife, Mavis, they flew, hopped through Africa at 800 miles a hop, right through Africa. They almost got a storm, almost knocked them over. And finally, they got to London. But what happened? They couldn't find the airport. They were lucky that they were crying Mayday, Mayday, and Biggin Hills, the airport that Douglas Bader was the hero of the Battle of Britain. That's what he headed up. Incidentally, Douglas Bader came to Cape Town and walked up the steps of Sachs Junior School. This was roughly the same time, and in 1959. And he walked up the stage and he looked at us little kids and he smiled and he said, I bet you thought I was going to fall. Anyway, he had no legs. So he had artificial legs. So anyway, so there they were in London, and they went through to Scotland to play in the Open. And at the Open, now you must understand, he had never played in a white tournament. He had never played in a big stage or in on proper white golf courses. And he in the practice round, he practiced with Gary Player, and then he shot a 30 and a 68, and so there was a big, he gained a lot of attention. And then they came to the actual qualifying rounds for the Open. Luke, are you back with us?
I am back. Sorry, okay. Barry. You'll have to interview me. I'm trying to work out where you are, but you're doing wonderfully, so you just continue.
I can continue, not a problem.
Okay, thank you.
So anyway, he managed on the very last hole to sink a long 15-foot putt, and he made the he qualified on the mark for the last 59. And he played in the Open. He didn't do too well. It was the Open, the first major that Gary Player won. And afterwards, he was feeling a little bit despondent, but Graham Wolf said, don't worry, we're going to go to the French Open. Unfortunately, they got the date of the French Open incorrect. They were actually waylaid by security police from South Africa. And so they said, don't worry, we're going to go to the Dutch Open. So they went to the Dutch Open, and what do you think? He won the Dutch Open against a top-class field. So this is 1959. This totally unknown fellow from the bush playing with a reverse grip wins the Dutch Open. He comes back to South Africa, and there are 2,000 people meeting him at Durban, at Johannesburg, and then Durban Airport. But lo and behold, he goes out into the street and it's purported that 100,000 people met him in a cavalcade all the way back to his shack. They were cheering and screaming and trying to jump on the car, and he was a total hero to the people, especially the Indian people in Durban. Of course, the white press hardly even gave it any mention. It was an anomaly, it was a fluke, and that was it. The only problem is, the following year, he went back to play in the Dutch Open and he won it for a second time. Now, very few people have won it twice and very few people have won it two times in a row. Just to take the story of the Dutch Open slightly further, he actually won it three times in four attempts. Nobody's ever done that. And the only other people who've won it three times, you're talking of Bernard Langer and Seve Ballesteros. So you've got to understand, this was quite an amazing feat. He also, incidentally, was runner-up in 67. So now we get, they finally find a loophole that he's allowed to occupy the land of the golf course. Not, he can't go into the actual clubhouse. For some of you, well, I'm not sure if any of you remember Muizenberg and Cork Bay in those days, but in Cork Bay there was the Olympia Biscope. And down the white kids sat downstairs and the colored kids sat upstairs, and they used to throw water bombs down at us. But that's the same. You could occupy different spaces. So anyway, he got permission to play in the South African Open. He wasn't allowed to use the toilets or go into the clubhouse or anything. He was only allowed, and he wasn't allowed to practice. He was only allowed to be there on the day. But before the Open, he actually cut his hand, and he didn't do too well. He came 16th, and he didn't do too well. And so they decided, well, he's had his chance, and they left it at that. But in 63, by this stage, he was dominating the non-European TPA tour. To give you an example, between 1960 and 1970, he won it 10 times. So in between, only Ismail Chagli beat him. So in all, in fact, he won the South African non-European 11 times. And in 59, he was the South African non-European Sportsman of the Year. The previous year, it was Basil D'Oliveira. And then in 1963, and this is really where it gets interesting, they allowed him to play in the Natal Open. The Natal Open had all your champions, excepting Gary Player. Harold Henning was the favorite. And of course, what do you think happened? There he was, changing in a car and not able to go to the toilet. And really, it was, really was bad. Nevertheless, he won. He beat Harold Henning, he beat Bobby Favey, he beat Dennis Hutchinson, Kirby Lekhranji. So there they are, everybody's excited. And I must tell you that the galleries, he had huge, huge galleries of Indian women and men following him. They knew nothing about golf. They would sit on the green, on the edges of the green. They would talk. They just knew nothing. Nevertheless, he was an absolute folk hero. So there he was, getting his trophy. And what do you think happens? It's storming. The heavens in Durban open up. Now, we know what happens in Durban when it storms. We know when South Africa won that World Cup in 95, outstormed in the semi-final. So the players all sat in the clubhouse. Some of them watched it, some of them didn't. The Papwa had to get his trophy outside in the rain, and all the international photographers took photos. And the next day, there was another storm, and that was, the world was outraged, especially India, at the treatment he had received, which led to India having South Africa banned from the 1964 Olympics, and Papwa becoming the figurehead of the anti-apartheid sport movement. And yet he was apolitical.
And
ask.
And I recall that he was in fact offered the position of the professional at the Royal Calcutta Golf Club, which I seem to remember he turned down. And all of that was basically a follow-on from his photograph being seen in the Indian papers when he had to receive this trophy in the rain in 63 after having won the Natal Open. Is that right?
I would imagine so. This was in 1967 when he was invited to take part in the Indian Open, where once again, he was hailed as a movie star. He was an icon where he couldn't even walk out into the street and buy some toothpaste. He was mobbed wherever he went, and he didn't do too well. He didn't do too bad. It was very hot. He came sixth. But then the Royal Calcutta Golf Club, which has about I think it's about 3,500 members, and had only the year before elected an Indian captain. Until then, it's always been the white fellows. But then they asked Papwa to be their club professional, and they offered him a house, and they offered him a very good salary, and he could still go and play in some tournaments. And by that stage, of course, one must realize he was already 39, or going on 39. Which basically, he's at the end of his career or near the end of his career. And given that he didn't have money behind him, and at that stage he didn't have a sponsor, I'm running ahead of our story now, but a lot of bad things had happened to him in South Africa, and yet he turned it down, believing that the government would change their outlook on him. You know, just like a lot of people stayed in Germany when the Nazis came along, so he stayed in South Africa.
Did you, in writing the book, did you get the feeling that his belief that the government might change their attitude towards him was sort of the sole factor for him refusing the offer from Royal Calcutta?
It was a combination of that and the fact that his wife didn't want to leave her circle, their tight community. And so that seems to have been the reason.
I'm kind of, when my internet link lapsed, I'm not quite sure what I missed out. So if I'm covering what you spoke about, forgive me, but have you spoken about the assassination attempt on his life, Barry?
No, I think maybe if I can just continue with the story a little bit to catch up to Royal Calcutta, that is the really important time. So there he was in 63, and he had won the Natal Open. Now they found it very difficult to say no to him playing in some tournaments. He did play, they did say no to some of them, but they allowed him to play in the South African Open in 1964, and he came second. He started the final day tied with the brilliant Retief Waltman, and Retief beat him by one shot. But the fact that he had come second in the South African Open, this unknown, this person who nobody had really knew who he was, was remarkable. So he then went on, of course, by then the security police were breaking into his house and searching, and want to know if he's a terrorist or bringing messages for the ANC. And he was also in Cape Town, hoping to play in the Western Province Open. He was staying at an activist, Sissy Ghoul, and they broke into the house there and threatened they were going to send him off to Robben Island, where, of course, they had sent Nelson Mandela, Oliver Tambo, and all the others. And so Papwa had actually taken the place of the leadership of the ANC, because now they had somebody else to focus on. So now we come to 19. So he goes to play in the General Motors at Wedgwood in Port Elizabeth, and the night before, that he and his manager are given a caravan to stay in on the course. Of course, not allowed in the clubhouse, no practice rounds, no nothing. And there he is in the caravan, and he looks outside, and the security people have all disappeared. It's very dark, and he and his manager get scared, and they decide to go off into Port Elizabeth and find some accommodation. They come back the next morning. They jovial. They teasing each other. They don't know why they were so scared, and they get to the caravan, and they about to open the door, and suddenly they realize that the caravan's reeking of gas. They open the door. There's just lots of gas, and they get the maintenance manager, and they find that the pipe leading into the stove from the outside had been severed overnight. And of course, gas is a silent killer. So there was an attempt on his life. The security police have threatened that it would happen. And anyway, so now we move on to 1965. And lo and behold, in the Natal non-European Open, he's beaten for the first time. This is all the press said, this is it. He's no good anymore. He's done his day. But he enters again for the Natal Open, and the government decide that because he had beaten the South Africans in the Dutch Open, Dennis Hutchinson and so on, and because he had beaten Harold Henning, they needed their hero, Gary Player, to put Papwa in his place. And at that time, this was exactly the same time as Cassius Clay, later Muhammad Ali, was fighting the return match against Sonny Liston and the world for the heavyweight title, the world listened. Over here, finally, Gary and Papwa were going to be matched for the golf heavyweight title. And they proceeded to play. And the last round, which the last day, they played 36 holes and they were paired together. And with one round to go, they were level as well as Harold Henning. So Gary, Harold and Papwa were level going into the last round. Initially, Gary took a 3-shot lead over them, but they fought back. Harold had a great round, but it wasn't good enough, and Papwa, in the end, won by 1 shot. Now, the galleries were huge. You had Gary's gallery of white people, and you had Papwa's gallery of Indian people and black folk, and this was too much for the government. And immediately following it, oh, by the way, at both those Natal Opens in the last round, during the last round, the SABC pulled the plug on the commentary. No mixed sport.
And no radio.
So anyway, the government decides they're going to ban mixed galleries at sporting events. Well, if that's not enough, they then inform Papwa that he must leave his home in Riverside and go and live in Chatswood. Riverside is now a whites area, Group Areas Act. You think that's bad? They then tell Papwa he's banned from playing any further tournaments in South Africa. Of course, he goes overseas and Rhodesia and Zambia, he wins there, goes, plays Natal, Dutch Open, runner up. So the government decided to take away his passport. Now, he had just been to play in the Indian Open, and that's where we're up to. You want to take it further?
Have we spoken at all about his unorthodox grip and how that came about?
You've frozen. Oh dear.
Barry?
Would you repeat that?
I was just asking, yes. Have you spoken at all about his unorthodox grip and how that came about?
No, I did mention that he held his grip this way, the wrong way round. But okay. What happened was while the caddies were waiting to get a bag, they would congregate in a small area. And of course, like all kids and everybody, they want to have a little competition amongst themselves. So they would put tins in the ground and they would find a golf ball or an acorn or whatever they did, but they didn't have golf clubs. They couldn't afford it. So they would take a piece of iron and they would roll it up, the bottom part, they'd roll it up. And then they would play with that that piece of iron. But the piece of iron, because it was so light at what is called the head of the club, the bottom of the club, to get the ball, the acorn, or whatever they were playing with, up into the air, they used a reverse grip. And so all the caddies played with the reverse grip, and it was originally called the caddy grip, but then later it became synonymous as the Papwa grip. He is the only person to have won a national tournament playing with a reverse grip. And he was probably the first person of color to win in Europe a national tournament. Today, you see many people putting with a reverse grip, but they don't play. The person who followed Papwa, who took over his mantle, Vincent Chabalala, he used to play his long irons with a reverse grip, but that's it. Ishmael Chagli, Papwa, both reverse grips.
Why did his story touch you so, Barry?
I played golf at Clovelly, and Ishmael Chagli was the caddy master. He was also a mentor of mine, and I regarded him as a friend. Obviously, I was a little boy, a teenager, and I didn't understand how prominent Ishmael was in the non-European circles. He and Papwa, at certain stages, Ishmael was regarded as better than Papwa. He won 2 South African non-European titles, and he won 15 non-European provincial titles. That's more than anybody else other than, of course, Papwa. And so he was Papua's main opposition amongst people of color. And I watched them play. They did a charity game with Gary Play and Vincent Chabalala in 74 at King David. And that's actually where it started, that I got involved with building the South African Golf Museum and then the Hall of Fame and the inductions. And so I learned a lot, but I discovered that There were no books written about black golf, and there was no records of black golf. And so I enjoyed the research and I put it together, but Papwa was a story that had to be told. He is probably the greatest unknown golfer in the world. And if he'd had a chance, if the government had given him a chance, he certainly could have won a major. He was that good.
I remember you telling me once that he was sponsored by liquor manufacturers, and rather than being sponsored, but you know, being paid by the sponsors, there was a kind of a, for want of a better phrase, there was a kind of a tot system employed, whereby he was paid in liquor, in alcohol. And ultimately that was very damaging on him, particularly later on in his career. Could you tell us a little bit about that, please?
Yeah, but, you know, South Africa, the dorp system of the farms are very well known and documented. What happened was there were only a certain amount of sponsors who would sponsor him when he won. They amongst the Indian and black community, the newspapers, and there were quite a few of them, there were a lot of adverts. And of course, Papwa, who was Sportsman of the Year in 59 and in 63, the various sponsors, you know, wanted him to be Brill Cream and Pepsi and whatever else it was. But they were reluctant to pay. At best, they paid, the one sponsor paid him 200 rand a year. But they were reluctant because they didn't want to earn the ire of the white public and especially the government. So instead, they paid him with liquor, whiskey, mainly whiskey. And at the same time, his manager, who should have been managing his money, instead they went out on sprees, on drinking sprees with their friends. And so Papwa started drinking. And of course, by 67, when they banned him, they incidentally, it was only in 72 that they unbanned him. But when they banned him, because he was too good and he had beaten Gary, and Gary was world number one then, that was the year he won the Grand Slam, US Open, and he, whole lot of other tournaments, the Canada Cup, the World Cup, and so on. So he started drinking, and at the end of his life, he was an alcoholic.
Sad story. Tease out what seems to be quite a complicated and quite a convoluted relationship between Papwa and Gary Player, if you would.
That's a question that a lot of people have asked, and I've given quite a lot of thought to it. I know Gary, and I knew Ishmael, and I watched Papwa. It's my belief. Well, firstly, Gary in 67 wrote that he was a man of Fawood and he supported apartheid, and that the whites lived amongst aliens who followed witchcraft and polygamy and a whole lot of other things, and that their wealth was in cattle. So Gary at that stage, one must understand, he also grew up poor. His mother died when he was young. His father worked on the mines. And coming from that background, they would all be supporters of the Nationalist Party. So one must also realize that, and Gary Gary left school. He didn't do matric. So one must realize that he was also 7 years younger than Papwa. There was in 67, 68, 67, Molly Reinhold, who was the doyen of the Sunday Times, before your time there, and there were letters between called the Molly Gary letters every Sunday, and she was castigating Gary, and Gary was trying to say why he wasn't doing more for Papwa, and he called her a sweet old lady, and she replied, "I don't mind you calling me old. I don't mind you calling me a lady, but sweet I never was." But anyway, so there they were, and Gary only started supporting Papwa in 1974 when he sent him, he paid for him, or 72, I think, 73. He paid for him to go to Australia with him. Of course, there were ulterior motives, because it was to deflect the attention of the anti-apartheid protesters by having Papwa with him in Australia, in Manly and Sydney. But and then he did send him overseas once to America to play in two or three tournaments, where incidentally Billy Casper came to have a look at him. Billy Casper was one of the four great golfers: Jack Nicklaus, Gary, Arnold Palmer, and Billy Casper. And Billy Casper was knocked out by Papwa. But anyway, so it was only then that he started to support him. But Gary did, and he also wrote another book in 74, where again he was a supporter of apartheid, but he wasn't as strongly supportive. But at that stage, he started supporting Vincent Chabalala, and he sent him in 74 overseas to America, where Vincent never broke 80. And then in 76, when Vincent, pulling his own cart in the final round of the French Open, won the French Open. And then in the 80s, things turned. And Gary became not only put up some money, quite a bit of money for the non-European tour, but he became quite vocal, and then against apartheid, and against a lot of the animosity the white golfers were having towards the black golfers, who were now being allowed to play in some tournaments because they were taking some of their money away from.
Yeah, just going back a step or two, when Gary sort of had the change of heart towards Papwa, when he was campaigning in Australia, you get the sense that in actual fact that might have been at the behest of Gary's management company, because he wasn't he managed by IMG at that stage? And didn't IMG think it was politic that Gary perhaps started appearing to change the color of his politics? So in other words, there is a theory which you might put forward to the effect that, you know, Gary didn't really have a spiritual change of heart or a political change of heart. He had a pragmatic change of heart.
It's a combination. I don't know for sure, but George Bloomberg, who was the sponsor of many of the South African golfers from Johannesburg, he was one of the founders of IMG, and it is, and he also supported Gary in a big way, financially initially. So it is highly likely that was the case. In America, Gary was now had a caddy called Rabbit, who was 6'8" or 6'10". And of course, Gary was 5'7" or even under 5'7". So they made quite a pair, and he became quite famous with Gary. And no doubt, Gary was being hounded by by the spectators and anti-apartheid movement. Balls were being rolled between his legs, telephone books thrown on his back, ice at him. The greens were ripped up with, "You'll never come back again, racist," and so on. And so there was a lot of, I mean, there were death threats. He was walking around with security guards. So it was necessary, both for his own living, to not be seen to be a supporter of apartheid. So it served his interest. Having said that, there are a number of people like Charlie Clifford, Sifford and others who said that they had a good relationship with Gary. So I think in America, everything was even and equal, and people were treated normally. It was only when his problems arose when he went overseas. Papua's problems arose when he came back to South Africa.
Is the logical extension of this book on Papua not perhaps the biography of Gary Player for you next?
I wouldn't dare. There have been so many books about Gary, and Gary, you know, what I was thinking about it, and I was thinking, you know, I tried to rank the golfers, both the black golfers and then overall, because Papua had never been ranked in South Africa, you know, on the top 20. You never saw his name. So no black golfer had ever been ranked. So when I did rank them, I thought about it, and I thought to myself, well, we know who's won the most tournaments, and we know who's won the most majors, but there were certain people who weren't allowed to play. In total, Papwa won at least 77 tournaments that I've been able to research, which is unbelievable. But so I try to work out, well, okay, who was actually the best golfer? Take away the number of victories and take away a number of majors. Who in a short period of time was the best golfer? And in my opinion, it was Bobby Locke. Gary second, Ernie Els, Nick Price. One of the other ones who come into that reckoning is Retief Waltman, who was unbelievably good, won 2 South African Opens, and retired at 25 to become a missionary. So getting back to Gary, his career has gone a long, long way. He did a lot of good. He did some things that maybe weren't so good. And when he won in 65, when he won the US Open, he gave the check back he donated it to cancer. So, you know, nobody else did that sort of thing. So who knows?
Did you speak at all about Graham Wolfe, Barry, and his role in Papa's early career and flying Papua to Europe in a light aircraft? Wolfe, and I love this story, sort of famously making his money in women's cosmetics and oil of Olay. Have you told that story?
Well, I mentioned it, that they flew over and in this light aeroplane, and he was a chemist in Durban, and he made the connection between a cream that made women feel younger and their skin softer, older women feeling younger and their skin softer, and hence oil of Olay, which today is about a $4 billion industry. But in 1967, for what he did for Papua, the Indian government flew him to India and they gave him an award for what he did for Papua.
Graham Wolfe an award.
Yes, no other white, you know, in those days, you must understand, aside from Helen Suzman, there were no other people speaking up for these white, these sportsmen of color. And that's why Basil de Oliveira went overseas. But they simply weren't speaking up. And here you get a benefactor, a white benefactor, who not only is a benefactor, but goes the extra mile and actually caddied for Papwa in the Dutch Open in 59. And he and his wife flying. And because, and this is just an aside, because Papwa couldn't read or write, they taught Papwa to write his name as if it was a painting. And they put on postcards pictures of where he had to go. And so he showed the people the picture, and then they helped to explain where he had to go. So they were heavily involved, and he continued to work at the factory until 1966, after he had beaten Gary, when he decided he was now going to go full-time as a professional, and he was going to, and that's what he did. He went full-time, he left his work, because now he thought he'd beaten the best in the world. The world's his oyster. And of course the government bans him and takes away his passport.
But isn't there a lovely little parallel there with Graham Wolfe and Papwa? Because didn't Papwa start out as being Graham Wolfe's caddy? And then Graham ended up being Papwa's caddy in the Dutch Open.
Almost there. They were in the same four ball, and he used to, but he did used to caddy for Graham. And then, of course, when he was working in the factory, every afternoon, he and Graham Wolfe used to go off and play golf. I wish I had that job.
What's given you the most pleasure in writing this book, Barry?
That the story is told, that people know the story, and that that now it's out there. You spoke about the other two books. The one was written by Judge Christopher Nicholson, who was very political. He made it very politicized.
You're talking about the other two books on Papwa.
Yes, he was very ANC pro, and he really, really gave Gary Player a very hard time in that book. The second book was written by a lady, Margaret Case or something like that. And she focused on the family and the Hindu religion and that side of Papwa. But it was important that the golf side and the competitors he played against and the actual golf story be told.
Why is there have been these three books about Papwa, but comparatively his memory has been neglected. No statue of Papwa, for example. Why do you think that is? Why do you think we have this amnesiac tendency about our past, unless it's a past which is conducive to the ANC representing itself in the best possible fashion?
There is a golf course, a very basic golf course in Durban now called the Papwa Sewgolum Golf Club.
Okay.
It's a municipal course. But aside from that, I believe it has a lot to do with the golf authorities here. They never really valued the history. In all the time, we had a golf museum which was rated one of the three best in the world of its kind. And in all those years, I've never seen any of the golf officialdom come and visit. When we had a function, an induction function, it's possible they went through the museum, but there was never any follow-up or never any interest. I think that it is only now that people are talking about Papwa. And I think he left a legacy. a legacy, and the youngsters are inspired, the young Indian golfers and young black golfers are inspired by somebody besides a white golfer.
There's apparently a film in the offing, Barry.
We hope so. I've got my fingers crossed. They have taken a Canadian company has taken the film rights. They're looking at a $10 million budget film with some major names, and to commence late next year. And we'll have to wait and see.
Has your golf game improved as a result of writing this book?
Holy mackerel, not a chance. I've gone backwards. I'm old. I've done my day. I had a lot of fun. I played with a lot of major names. I'm very lucky. I've still got Sally Little, who I grew up with as my very close friend. And Dale Hayes and Hugh Baaki and all those people, and David Frost and so on. But no, I don't play that much anymore, excepting when I'm dragged off to play. But I still love the game.
How would you have fared in an 18-hole an 18-holer with Papwa?
Papwa was brilliant. I was lucky enough. I had Bobby Locke took me under his wings when I was young, and Ishmael Chagli and so on. I wasn't even vaguely in their league. I was happy to be able to play in South African amateurs and those sort of things, but I wasn't a winner. I was a nachschlepper there, but the fact that I could play in it, that was good enough. But no, Papwa was way ahead. He was brilliant. His short game, that was his, he wasn't long off the tee, but he was an amazing short game player. And his chipping, especially with the reverse grip, that was where he was came to the fore. You know, each of the golfers have different strengths. Bobby Locke was putting. Gary Player bunker shots and from 100 yards, but so was Papwa. From 100 yards out, he was dynamite.
What's your next project?
I am busy with, I've been asked to be involved with two other books I'm co-writing. I have written another book with a business partner. But there is one book I want to write about some of the things I've been involved with in sport. So we'll wait for that, sport and entertainment.
Our audience out there, has anyone got any questions?
Well, while we're waiting, if there are any questions coming through, just remember if you are interested, this book has all the statistics as well as the full story of Papwa, and it's a very interesting book. It's certainly one that one will keep in your library. And if not, there's also my previous book, Blazing the Trail, which is the story of black golf, takes you through from the time golf started here, right through to 1993, 1994, when Louis Chitengwa won the South African amateur, beating Rory Sabatini, and then went on and won the World Junior Championship, beating the defending champion, Tiger Woods, and went to university in America, once again beating Tiger a few times, and went on to the Canadian Tour. He was going to be the next great golfer of color on the American Tour, and suddenly in a tournament in Canada. He had shot 67 in the third round, complained of a headache, and was taken to hospital, and the next day died of a rare form of meningitis. He had been visiting his family in the rural areas in Zimbabwe.
Barry, Beryl's looking very anxious. I think we should wrap it up.
Sorry, not meant to look anxious at all. I'm anxious about the fact that this is such an extraordinary story. And when we look back on the tragic absurdities of our past and how much talent we lost as a result of it, that makes me very sad rather than anxious that it took so long to come for the government to come to their senses. But be that as it may, I just want to thank you for an extraordinary story and very sad as well. And the fact that Papwa succumbed to alcoholism and the was given the DOP system virtually as payment. I mean, it is horrific in these days. But you tell it beautifully, Barry. And Luke, apart from the fact that you had a few network connections, which we're so used to, thank you very much for the patience. And just thank you for a wonderful evening, because I think that everybody that listened learned a lot. As Barry said, the books are available. They can be ordered through the Book Lounge on booklounge@gmail.com, or they're available on Amazon and in good bookstores. A very warm thanks to our audience for your support of the Jewish Literary Festival, to the sponsors and donors of JLF 2020, to Natasha Skorek for her technical coordination. Thank you, Tash, you're always there when we need you. And to the JLF team for the program coordination. Next week, we welcome Kate Sidley and a panel of three authors, Helen Moffat, Cornita Loxton, and Dawn Gerrish, as she asks them how you write Jewish characters when you're not Jewish. Is this where angels fear to tread? I think that that's going to also be a very interesting discussion. And then, of course, a reminder to watch your email inbox, diarize Thursdays at 8 p.m. for JLF at Home, or visit our website for further details. Until next week, good night, stay safe, warm, and well, and thank you for coming this evening.